SASE is all the buzz in IT and cybersecurity right now. What is it and why should you care? Let's find out. Hi, I'm Steve Murphy. I'm a vice president at ARG. And while I work for ARG, this video is my own and doesn't necessarily reflect the views of my employer. So let's talk about how we're going to spend the next couple of minutes. First thing we're going to do is define SASE. How is it evolving in the marketplace today? And what do people consider a SASE framework? Why you need SASE? What problems does it solve? Why SASE is going to be the future framework for IT security? And then lastly, how do you get started? How can we set you up for success and considering whether or not a SASE model is right for you? So let's jump into it. Gartner defined the term Secure Access Service Edge in August of 2019. Secure Access Service Edge, abbreviated SASE, pronounced SASE. Now, little did they know that 6 months later, most of corporate America would send their employees home due to the COVID-19 pandemic. But SASE was positioned to really enable organizations to take advantage of that and will be a driving force in how they consider security moving forward. SASE is a direct challenge to how we're doing security today, and it's important as we continue to evolve in utilization of cloud services and a work from anywhere type of mentality. Now, SASE advocates that we deliver security and other important access services to end users where they live, rather than bringing them back to a security stack in a corporate data center. This is essentially a meet users where they are mentality and promises a lot of benefits along the way. Let's take a look at those. So SASE has many benefits in its initial concept stage, but they have to be pretty strong in order to convince us to change what we're doing today. So what are those key benefits? We're going to improve the end user experience. They're going to get greater security by following a SASE framework. And that security is going to be increased partially because we're going to have better compliance. End users won't work around security infrastructure that's put in place because security infrastructure will no longer impede their ability to work efficiently. We're going to get a simplification of security tools, and they're going to be more integrated with the other tools. The service chaining will be more seamless and eliminate gaps that do occur as we stack individual point solutions from individual vendors. And we're going to get a improved orchestration plane or orchestration tool, single visibility through a portal of all the services that are included in the SASE model. And ultimately, we're going to lower costs. So we're going to get a lot of benefits and a lower cost structure. And I think we can all agree that if SASE can deliver, it will make a lot of sense with these key benefits. So let's take a look at what SASE does. So at a very high level, 40,000 feet, SASE combines network access services with security services and creates a unified plane to allow end users to work from any location on any device with the same security posture as they would have if they were working in a corporate office. So the combination of these elements is what drives the Secure Access Service Edge, or SASE. So how do these two elements come together? Well, SASE has a couple of different components in each of the categories that will ultimately be unified. Under the Network as a Service category, it includes carrier services, software-defined wide area networking, or SD-WAN, content distribution networks, bandwidth aggregation providers, and edge equipment. On the security side, there are a lot more components, such as firewall as a service, secure web gateways, CASB or cloud access security brokers, zero trust networking or secure remote access or VPNs, web application protection, DNS services, remote browser isolation, and even sandboxing. So we have a lot more security components than we do on the network side. So that's why I think SASE is really more of a security conversation than a networking conversation. So let's talk about why we have to make a change in the first place. Why do we need SASE? Well, the way we work has changed dramatically just over the last 5 years. We have a traditional corporate environment which might include a corporate office, remote offices, and remote workers. Today, most of those users access the corporate resources over one or two networks, either an MPLS network or a public internet network. If we're going over the public internet, we're typically using a VPN, a virtual private network, to secure our work environment. But the workspace has changed dramatically, as I said, over the last 5 years. Today, those workers, whether they're in the branch or at home, are doing a large part of their work in cloud services, not in the corporate data center. In fact, 80% of the workflows will be in the cloud by 2021. That's a remarkable transformation than just from a few years ago. So how we access the network and how we utilize the network also has to change. Today, most of our users are going through the corporate security stack, and then they reach back out to the public internet and hit those cloud services. It's a very inefficient hairpinning of traffic through the corporate data center. Not only does it introduce latency and the possibility of packet loss, but it's very expensive. Today in that corporate environment, we have an edge that might look like this. MPLS coming into a router, internet coming into a router, being switched out to hit a VPN concentrator, and ultimately being checked by the firewall before it actually gets to go through and access corporate resources. Now, most of these components are chargeable by either the amount of bandwidth that they're plugged into or the amount of consumption that they experience. When you hairpin traffic coming in from the public internet or from a private network and then sending it back out to the internet simply to apply security rules, you're paying for that traffic twice. SASE, however, changes this construct. We've got our traditional work environments here. We're going to leverage the public internet to get to all of those. We're going to have SASE services provided at the edge of the cloud that will secure and allow communications directly to the resources that your end user is trying to access. You don't have to hairpin through that corporate office security stack any longer because all of your security services are delivered at the edge of the cloud. In fact, SASE is one of the great examples of edge computing that we've been promised for such a long time. Clearly, there are some network efficiencies, but let's talk about what other efficiencies we get in a SASE environment. First of all, bandwidth optimization. You're no longer restricted to that private MPLS network from a single provider. You can select bandwidth from any provider that's available to your end user community. And that allows you to optimize cost. It allows you to provision services very quickly relative to an MPLS installation. And you can use aggregators. We recommend people use aggregators for this. That allows them to, again, keep that network objectivity without losing the efficiency of working with a single vendor. We also start to avoid that hairpinning element that saves on licensing, saves on equipment costs. We're going to consolidate that edge. We're going to simplify it, and we're going to reduce latency in the process. Then we're going to increase end user flexibility. Again, as I mentioned, they can use any device from any location off of any network without compromising security. And then lastly, we're going to be able to turn up services at new locations very, very quickly, both from a network connectivity side, being able to order, let's say, broadband services that are installed typically within 10 days. And we're also going to improve how we turn up these services at both the branch and for the employee. Not only do we have network benefits, but we also have management benefits. Now today, most organizations have multiple security solutions layered one on top of another. They're individually managed and they lack integration, unless you have something like a SIEM, which is bringing all of the information together artificially, providing some level of integration, at least correlation of services. SASE promises the ability to have a single posture with a single governance platform. Management through a single pane of glass and orchestration across multiple point solutions that allow not only for uniformity, but also integration, eliminating a lot of those gaps that can be created by individual point solutions. And then lastly, we're promising a lower cost profile. If you can buy all of these things integrated, they're less costly to manage, and as a subscription cost, we can get some cross-product discounting that's typically available. SASE sounds great, but it is very early and it is very immature. Not many vendors have a robust SASE story right now. And you already have a bunch of solutions that you've installed that you have useful life left on. So we're not advocating that you immediately run off and transform your business into a SASE service model, but it is a journey that we want to encourage you to consider entering upon. Gartner's vision may not be your roadmap. You have to determine what your own roadmap is. But as SASE evolves, it's important for you to consider the benefits that you may get over time. We recommend that organizations start a SASE strategy by moving into service provider solutions that do have those SASE components, and selectively, over time, moving more and more of those services into that SASE strategy. So for example, if this year you're considering upgrading your endpoint security solution. Now, endpoint security isn't part of the SASE story according to Gartner. I personally think it should be, but let's just use that as an example. By moving into a SASE strategy one solution at a time, you can ensure that it's the right fit for your organization, and you can make reasonable and measured judgments as to whether or not your SASE strategy will support the individual solution that you're considering. So what are your next steps? Well, I'd appreciate it if you take a moment just to like this video if you got some value out of it, and to subscribe if you want to find your way back to this channel in the future. And then if you want to have a conversation around SASE or any other security topics or any other network as a service topics, I'm going to put my contact information in the video description. Feel free to reach out to me. I'd be happy to have a quick conversation and talk to you about what some of your options might be. And with that, I appreciate your time and watching this video. I hope you have a great day, and I'll see you next time. Thanks so much.